Just as a reminder, I'm Keenan from Chelsea Rockman's lab at the University of Toronto. I am a lab manager and research assistant at U of T. I did my undergrad in aquatic toxicology at Queen's University, and then I did my master's at U of T in ecology before Chelsea was a prof there. I've been working with microplastics since 2015, so I have a fair bit of experience in this. Since graduating, I worked for the provincial government of Ontario and the University of Toronto. I worked on the SFBI Five Gyres Monitoring Project, and I've also done a lot of Raman for various other projects at U of T and other academic institutes. Right now, I'm working on a multi-phase project, partly with Kariba, developing Raman automation for microplastics, and I'm also doing a survey of large top predators, marine top predators, looking for microplastics and potential for translocation.
I'm Hannah. Just a bit more detail about me. I'm a research assistant in the Rockman Lab at U of T. I did my undergrad in England, I studied marine environmental management at the University of York, hence the diving. And then since then, I've been working at U of T for about a year. When I first started, I was working a lot on FTIR, Raman, helping with a lot of analysis of some samples that we had, including some of the SFBI stuff as well. And since then, and more recently, I've been helping out with this project. So we've been looking through the methods and developing the SOPs, and I'll be helping along the way, all the way through to the data management and analysis at the end.
So we've already done introductions, but I just want to get a sense for how familiar everybody is, not with the instrument training, but specifically with microplastic morphologies and extractions. So if you're very experienced with identifying and extracting microplastics, you can raise your hand. Okay, if you have like a medium level, some experience, but not too much. Okay, and is anybody pretty new to the field of microplastics? Okay, good. Hopefully we can all get you to the experience level by the end of this.
Okay, so we're gonna try and get through quite a fair bit today, hence why we asked you to come so early, I'm very sorry. First of all, we're gonna go through the keys that we'll be using for the study, so characterizing microplastics by morphology and by color. We're then going to go into the lab and do some practice of that, so we've got some samples set up for you to go through and identify different particles. And then we're going to go through picking and organizing your particles once you've identified them, and have some practice in the lab of that as well. And then this afternoon, we're going to go through an overview of all four different SOPs, so for clean water, dirty water, sediment, and fish tissue. But we're going to go through those in much more detail tomorrow and do demonstrations in the lab tomorrow. But at the end of today, we're going to do a quick demonstration of the filtering SOP because that's pretty quick and easy. So hopefully we get through it all.
Will your PowerPoint be available?
Yes.
So I know about a third of you said you were very experienced with identifying microplastics. So some of this is going to be repetitive, and if you were at the last board meeting that I presented at, a lot of this is the same. But the goal here is to have it standardized for this study. It makes it much easier to compare among labs and process the data if we're all analyzing microplastics in the same way. So we've presented a key for microplastic morphologies that we'd like you to follow, as well as a key for color identification. So I know this might be slightly different from what you do in your labs, but for this study, please use these categories for morphology. So we have fragment, sphere, pellet, fiber, fiber bundle, foam, and film, and I'll go into more detail about what falls under each of these categories. So fragments are the most varied morphology category. In general, fragments are hard with rigid edges. They don't break easily when compressed, and they tend not to bend or fold. So I say don't break easily because with enough weathering and enough time in the environment, some things will just break anyways. Fragments can come in a multitude of shapes, so from angular to rounded, as you can see in the photographs. There's lots of different examples here. It's important to note that some fragments, particularly in the large size categories, might first appear to be fibers. So an example of this is this one here. It looks fiber-like, but if you touch it and it doesn't bend or fold, it's hard and rigid, then instead I would categorize that as a fragment. have spheres. So spheres are relatively easy to identify. These are often what we commonly think of as microbeads. Spheres are perfectly spherical with no irregularities, so no dense or fractured edges unless extensive weathering has occurred. Either way, they should be still obviously spherical. Spheres can be hard and resistant to breakage, or they can be somewhat malleable if they're plastic, but they should not crumble into a powder with pressure. For example, polyethylene spheres, so the microbeads from cosmetic products or cleansers, are hollow, so they may pop when you squeeze them with pressure. That's normal. Some spheres we've observed in our sediment or our stormwater, SFEI, which is like the road water runoff, or glass. So those are clear and very hard and rigid. They're still anthropogenic, but if you looked at them under a high resolution microscope and you squeezed them with your forceps, you wouldn't be able to make tiny indents in the surface the way that you would if it was a plastic sphere. So they might fracture like breaking glass, but you shouldn't be able to make little tiny indents. Glass spheres, again, like I said, are still anthropogenic, which is interesting. And if you're unsure of whether a sphere is glass or plastic, you should still pick it out and count them as spheres. Next, we have pellets. We also call these nurdles or pre-production pellets, but for this project, we just call them pellets. They are sometimes similar in shape to spheres, so you can have rounded ones, although it tends to be more of a flattened oval shape than a perfectly round sphere. They're also usually larger in size. Pretty often they'll be in that 3 to 5 millimeter size range. You can also see rectangular or cylindrical pellets, but you should be able to see, if you have a high resolution microscope, edges or lines where they've been machine cut on either end if they are rectangular or spherical. They can be clear, opaque, or white in color, but as you can see here, sometimes you'll see brightly colored pellets as well. Biggest indicator of pellets is they clearly look unnatural and they're pretty large in size. And like I said before, if they're plastic, they'll be somewhat malleable, so if you squeeze on them, you should be able to make a tiny mark versus like completely shattering it. Next, we have fibers. So fibers are usually pretty easy to identify. They're strand or string-like. They can come in any color. And due to the dyeing process, it's pretty easy to identify anthropogenic fibers because a lot of them are like brightly unnaturally colored. However, some might have bleached or white portions, so that can come from aging or if it wasn't dyed evenly in the manufacturing process. Fibers are very flexible. They're easy to bend and twist in all directions, so that's how you can tell a large, thick one apart from a fragment. The ends of fibers are not all the same, so if you look at these images, this one can have blunt ends, and this one here may have frame ends. Fibers can be a tricky particle if they're clear to identify between a cellulosic fiber or an anthropogenic fiber. So I'll go into a little bit more detail on that, my tips and tricks for identifying anthropogenic fibers. Fiber bundles are defined typically as 20 or more individual fibers that are tightly wound together. They can't be easily teased apart. If you try to separate them, you'd likely break the fiber, so it'll lead to more individual fibers than were originally present. So we try to avoid breaking them up, so don't tease them if you don't think you can. Again, I'll go into more detail on this in a minute. With fiber bundles, please report them as the dominant color and pick them as one item together. Additional colors can be noted, and again, I'll go into this in a second, in the notes section of your Excel file. So when you're counting your particles, there is a spot for you to add in more information that doesn't fit in the regular drop-down columns. So fiber bundles, again, it can be difficult to tell whether you should count them as individual fibers or as a bundle. So you should only classify them as fiber bundles if it looks like there's 20 or more individual fibers present, or if they're too tightly wound to tease them apart. So this one here looks like it might actually only be a couple of fibers, not 20, but it's so tightly wound that if you tried to tease that apart, you'd probably break it. In this case, err on the safe side and just count it as a fiber bundle. With this one here, looks like it's more than 20 individual fibers in a tightly wound mass. So again, I would count this as a fiber bundle. If you look, there's a black one that's wound into the red one. So if I came across this, what I would try to do carefully is tease out the black one if I can and count that as a separate one, since it doesn't really fit within the categorization of a bundle. Bundles should be consistent in color and appearance. If I can't pick this black fiber out, again, err on the safe side, pick it out as one, count it as a fiber bundle. I would call it red, since red is clearly the dominant color here. But in the notes section, I would also write like one black fiber or a couple of black fibers right next to it. This is an example of fibers that should not be counted as a bundle. So for this one, there are several of them here, but I can't quite tell if it's 20 or more. They're loosely wound. They're different in color and different in appearance. They also look like they have slightly different thicknesses. So what I would do is try to tease this one apart. I probably could. It doesn't look like it's too tightly wound, but if I could not tease this one apart and it is this loose, what I would do is count ends to get an estimate of the minimum number of fibers present. So, again, as I mentioned before, another tricky task is trying to tell anthropogenic fibers from cellulosic fibers. So this depends on the question that you're asking in your study, whether or not you're interested in the anthropogenic fibers. So we've made the decision for this study to count all colored fibers since they're anthropogenic, and with colored fibers, dyed fibers, it's very difficult to use these tips and tricks to tell whether or not it's cellulosic. So if it's a dyed fiber, please count it and pick it out. You can note in the comments section if you think it's a cotton fiber or a cellulosic fiber, if there's any like really big indicators that it might be that, but please still count it. If it's a clear fiber, do your best to try to tell whether or not it's a synthetic fiber. For clear fibers that are cellulosic, there are a few things in common. It's a little bit tricky to see here, but if you have a microscope in front of you, it tends to be easier to tell. There may be tapered edges. So for this one, it's thicker in the middle and it tapers and looks wispy on the ends. So that's one characteristic feature of a cellulosic fiber. Another one, again, tricky to tell in these photos, but once you see it under a higher resolution microscope, it becomes more clear, is an uneven surface texture. So a synthetic fiber may have little round spheres along the surface that you can see if you look under, say, a Raman microscope. But under a regular microscope, it can look the cellulosic fiber looks like it has roughness to the texture, so it would be like divots of uneven sizes. These little divots along the surface of the fiber can reflect light back at you, so it would look like a weird uneven shininess. Another tip is to look for spiny projections that come off of the main body of the fiber. So if you look here, there's like the main body of the fiber here, and tiny little projections that are coming off of it throughout the whole body of the fiber. It doesn't look like fraying, it looks different from that. It looks most similar, in my opinion, to branching plant roots. And then another thing to look for is if the main body of the fiber splits. So you'll see the fiber consistent along and it'll divide, and it look kind of like tree branches. Synthetic fibers tend to have a more smooth surface texture. Like I mentioned, they may have bubble-like spheres along the surface, and you can look at them with a really high-resolution microscope. They tend to be more tensile and resistant to breakage, whereas cellulosic fibers break apart relatively easily. And then the main body of the fiber is typically pretty smooth with few projections. You may see fraying, but fairly often the fraying is conserved to the ends of the fiber. Obviously, as you're extracting particles from environmental matrices, it's highly likely that you'll see some things that are not microplastic. So these are some of the natural materials that you may come across. Salt and sand look fairly similar. They're often clear or brown in color, although sand may have some like brightly colored mineral particles in it as well, so be on the lookout for that. Salt tends to break apart pretty easily, so it can be crushed with your forceps. Sand does not break apart quite so easily, but if you do press it with forceps, you may be able to crack it, although if you can get down to the level where you look at the surface of it, the cracks look different. So I've explained a couple of times how you can kind of indent the surface of a plastic with your forceps. So a plastic fragment, for example, if you squeeze it with forceps, may have a tiny indentation like this after you squeezed it versus a sand particle that cracks more like glass. So if you squeeze it, you may see like fractures or striations appear on the surface of it. Coal dust and fly ash are another thing that you may come across. Typically they're black or gray. The biggest indicator is how easily they crush. So it could be a black fragment. Sometimes it also presents as a black sphere, which can be confusing. So if you see these black spheres and they're shiny, try crushing them. If it explodes into a powdery dust, it's probably coal or fly ash. Shells and bones are a little more easy to identify, although they can look like fragments sometimes. Again, the easiest way is to tell how easily they can be crushed. So a shell will fragment fairly easily. And bones will fragment pretty easily as well, especially if they've been treated with wet peroxidation or potassium hydroxide. If they've been treated with either of these things, they also tend to have this like orangey tinge to them. Another thing you may come across, which at first glance can look like plastic, are otoliths from fish. So they're calcium carbonate structures. They're pretty hard and thick, and they also tend to have a fairly distinctive appearance, and they're pretty large relative to microplastics. They can have like a little flowery appearance, scalloped edges on the outside. They're calcium carbonates, so they should be pretty shiny as well. Algae and plant matter are fairly easy to distinguish. They can be brown, green, opaque, sometimes a little on the clear side, but they're brittle and they break fairly easily when touched. Another thing to look out for are microscopic organisms. So these can come in a range of colors, but most of them are brown or green. And a good thing to look for are antennae or legs.
So in here, you'll have all of the morphology keys with some pictures. There'll be the color key in here as well. And then we've also got a second part which we'll give you later, which is all the SOPs, with some like, things to remember for each one. So while Keenan's giving those out, I'll just go through the color key really quickly. So this is the color key that we will be using for the study. As you can see, it's pretty simple. It's all the major colours plus some extras at the bottom. So the goal for this was to keep it really simple so that everyone knew which colours we were using and it was simple for everyone to follow, and also for consistency and harmonisation, so to compare between samples, between matrices and between labs. So this is what we've decided. So one thing with colours is that it can be quite subjective. It can depend on the microscope you're using or who's looking at it. One thing I would say is trying to spend too long trying to decide if something's black or grey or yellow or orange. You can ask someone for a second opinion, but just go with what you're confident with, because you can spend ages trying to decide. And because of this, in certain circumstances, a lot of these colours are the same. So for example, white and clear. This can be difficult because, especially with fibres, when you shine the microscope light on them, they can become shiny and look white, so it can be quite hard to tell. But just go, one thing to remember for that is white particles are solid and have a solid white colour. Clear obviously is clear and transparent or see-through, so just go with what you think. Another one is yellow or orange, for example. And then the other colours at the bottom, so we've got multicoloured, silver and gold. Multicoloured I would only use in specific circumstances. So if you've got a fragment, for example, and it's got three different colours in it, none of those colours are dominant, I would classify that particle as multicoloured. Same with fibre bundles. If you've got a multicoloured fibre bundle, like one of the photographs that Keenan showed earlier, and you can't tease them apart, it would be a multicoloured fibre bundle. Silver and gold differ from yellow, orange and grey in that they are very obviously metallic particles with a shiny reflective surface. So say if you saw a particle of glitter, that would be silver or gold. To keep this simple, these are some example things you should have used. So in previous projects we have used colours such as light blue, dark blue and sub-categorised. But for this we're going to keep it really simple because they all come under the same category. So no light blues and no dark greens. Also things like magenta, teal, terracotta, none of those. Is terracotta an English colour or an English word? Because Keenan told me it was
Yeah, in Southern California it is.
Yeah, so none of those. Kina mentioned earlier, some fibers can be bleached along their surface. So for example, this one, it's got red with bleached portions. We would assign this based on the dyed portions. So this would be a red fiber. You could make a comment in your notes saying that there were bleached portions, but you would classify it as red. But other fragments and other categories, multicolored particles are possible, or you can get some fragments with text on them sometimes with larger particles. With this, again, assign it based on the dominant color. So this particle here is yellow. It's got white patches around the edges, but the obvious most dominant color would be yellow. So we classify it as a yellow fragment. Okay.
We went really quickly.
So that's good. We've got lots of time. Yes?
I love this micro.